Welcome. I'm Pastor Art Nealon from Federal Heights, Colorado, and I'm here today. I'm very excited to bring a message I believe is so important for the hour that we live in. And our evangelism department at our church is called World Changers for Christ. And what we believe at Thrive Church is that one person and God make a majority. And you can go through the Bible and you can see people like David that hooked up with their God and were able to defeat Goliath and change the course of their nation. And I'm so excited today to share about what I believe a concept that every church can be a part of to help change their city for Jesus. And what we do on a weekly basis in Denver, Colorado, is we take teams downtown to the 16th Street Mall, and we basically have church on the street. And it's such an amazing, simple, amazing, and inexpensive concept that you can do even in your own town. And what we do is we'll go down right in the middle of the marketplace where there's people from every nationality, every background, every economic background. And we just set up and begin to worship the Lord. People begin to preach the gospel. How many know that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation? And so we believe that. We believe that the Word of God has power. The Word of God will not return void, but will go and do what it was sent forth to accomplish. We believe that. And as we begin to fill the airways with God's Word and the worship that brings God's presence, something amazing happens right in downtown Denver, and the presence of the Lord begins to just permeate in that area where we're set up. It's so exciting. The Bible says that we can't even come to Jesus unless the Holy Spirit draws us. And I believe the Lord is looking for people just to go and begin to share the truth of the gospel. And he's going to start drawing people unto himself. And so I want to read you a portion of scripture today to kind of back up this idea of church on the street. I want to back it up scripturally. And what a great book to go to than the book of Acts. It shows us how the first church did it. And it says here in Acts chapter 5, starting with verse 12, and it says, "And through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done by the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch." That is so exciting. Solomon's porch was outside the temple. It was actually by the east gate of the temple. And the disciples and the early Christians would meet there every day and worship God. And they were in one accord at Solomon's porch, yet none of the rest people, unsaved people, dared to join them, but the people esteemed them highly. So there was such a reverence and an awe of God's presence there that people didn't even dare join the group unless the Holy Spirit was drawing them. And the believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women, so that they brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Oh, this is such a great portion of scripture. I still believe the book of Acts should be lived out today. I believe there should be an Acts chapter 29. In the old King James Version, there's no period at the end of chapter 28. I like that. That means it should still be being continued and being lived out today. Same power, we got the same Holy Ghost power that they had in the book of Acts, amen? So as we begin to just take Jesus out of the building and go right where mass humanity is, God begins to show up in amazing, amazing ways. I remember First time that I was a part of a ministry that did this years back in the 1990s in New York City as part of an outreach there. And they set up church on the street, right down where all the prostitutes were and the strip clubs and the drug dealers on the street corner, right in that area of town. And we had Christians on either side of the sidewalk. And as people would come out of these strip joints, they'd have to walk right in between two rows of Christians that were worshiping God. And it was so amazing to see how the power of light can dispel the awfulness of darkness. And as people begin to walk past us and between these two rows of Christians singing and worshiping their Lord, the Holy Spirit, the conviction of the Holy Spirit would start taking a hold of these people's hearts. Yeah, it was so beautiful. Right on the streets in New York City, there was people that were breaking down in tears. People were getting ministered. By the time they walked all the way through that line of Christians worshiping, there was people that were weeping and getting personal prayer. I remember one particular individual, backslider, rededicated his life to the Lord. He just began to shout, "Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus," as he went through that line of people that were worshiping the Lord. And it showed me something. It showed me that God is not intimidated by the world. A lot of times we think God's maybe going to be afraid or something to be out there in the world, but God is wanting to show who he is. Taste and see that the Lord is good. He's looking for his people to bring his presence in the darkest of places so he can show his marvelous light. And I'm so excited. I remember a different outreach I was at in San Francisco, and we were done with the day of ministering and walking back on Market Street there. And I remember as I was going down the sidewalk, I passed by a pet store, and in the window was a goldfish. There was a goldfish for sale, and I remember how amazed I was, because I always thought the goldfish is like the 2-inch little fish that usually dies on you after a week or two. But this goldfish was, wow, a couple feet long. And big size. I had to stop, and I marveled, how did a little teeny goldfish get so big? And I believe the Lord began to speak to my heart. It's so cool how God can speak to you. He can speak to you at any time in any way. And I remember the Lord speaking to me. You know, the difference was when that goldfish was little, it was in a little fishbowl. People have them at home in a little fishbowl. But this fish is not no longer in a little fishbowl, but he's in this great big aquarium. Great big aquarium. And the Lord began to show me something there. He spoke to my heart that, wow, I want my Christians, I want my people to go from being little teeny minnows and dwarfed Christians into, we want to see them grow into full stature of Christ. We want to see them become everything that God intended them to be. But to do it, this is so good. This is the punchline that God had for me. To do it, you got to get the Christian out of the fishbowl, and you got to get him into the aquarium. And I love it. Boy, what we do in Denver, by just taking Jesus out of the box of going into the aquarium, if you will, of downtown Denver, just to see even our own people, the people that are on our team, how they've grown. It's like you don't really get more of God until you need more of God. And as you position yourself to be used by God in a needy setting, God gives you what you need, and you begin to grow. You begin to have a boldness. You overcome fear, and you become the Christian that God intended you to be. So I'm so excited. It says right here that even the shadow of Peter, as Peter was walking down the streets, it said that they were bringing sick people, and they were laying them on the streets. This is so amazing. It's not that they're taking them inside the temple. Nothing wrong, of course, with going into the church or a building, of course. But the point here is how awesome they were actually laying people out on the sidewalk that were sick and needy. And they were hoping that maybe even just the shadow of Peter would pass by them and they would be made whole. Well, it's so exciting just studying this word shadow. In the Greek, it actually means being overshadowed. It's not, wow, this is so great. This is where you go from the natural to the supernatural. The shadow of Peter is not just a dark outline of a person going over them as a normal shadow, but the shadow that was going over the sick and the lame actually overshadowed the people. It was a supernatural shadow. It's reference to the glory, the Shekinah glory talked about in the Old Testament. As he walked down the street, the Shekinah glory that was an overflow from him would touch other people, and they would be miraculously healed on the street. Boy, I don't know about you, but that gets me excited. If that doesn't make you excited out there in TV land, then your wood's wet. That doesn't get you fired up. And I'm here to tell you, pastors and leaders, wow, we keep doing the same thing that we've been doing. We're going to keep getting the same thing we've been getting. I just encourage you to, hey, let's dare to go there. Let's dare to do something different. Let's dare to go out and be a part of the community and let our light shine for Jesus, and you're going to radically change your own people, and the people in that area will get to hear the gospel. That's so wonderful. That's a win-win situation. And I just encourage you, on the screen has my information on there. I just encourage you, if you're a church leader, even if you are a person out there that maybe has a heart to win souls, that you would contact me. You would contact me, and we would love to talk with you. We'd love to maybe come into your church and preach and teach and actually help you set up a ministry there of evangelism and church on the street and just begin to see some wonderful things happen with your congregation. So we're so excited. I believe that we're living in a time that God's going to move in the earth again in a powerful, powerful way. I believe that God's raising up his army at this very time for the end time, last end time great ingathering of souls. And I want to be a part of it, and I want to help other people be a part of it as well. A number of years ago, the Lord did lead me to write a book, and I encourage you to get this book. We'd love to get this book to you. You can go to witnessdepot.org and order the book there. It has about 30 years of what I've learned, and a lot of times, sometimes you learn by, hey, that didn't work. We need to do something different this time around. So it's got a lot of experience in there. It has a lot of scripture. It talks about revival. Once we start seeing God's people revived, then there's going to become an awakening to the lost. And so I'm so excited. I just encourage you to check out our website there. There's all kind of material on there to help equip you to become an evangelist. So I am so excited. The Spirit of the Lord is doing a great work in these days, and we just want to help any way we can to see you be a part of it. I just want to say a quick word to my senior pastor, Pastor Bo and Teresa Sosa, awesome man and woman of God there at Thrive Church. I encourage you today, if you're a pastor, if you're a senior pastor, to welcome evangelism. Welcome evangelism again. We're kind of living in a time where we've gotten away from that. And I just encourage us to become the church of the book of Acts again. We can take ground for God. We don't have to lose ground. We don't have to retreat to the world. We don't have to try to be like the world to win the world. And in all honesty, a seeker, a sincere seeker, is looking for something different than what they've already experienced. They're hoping there's something different than the world that they've experienced. And we want to offer that. Christianity is something that transcends the natural, so much more fulfilling, life-giving than just what the world has to offer. And I want to encourage pastors today to lead the way. I just want you to lead the way. It says in 2 Timothy, Paul is writing to Timothy, and he admonishes him to do the work of an evangelist and fulfill your calling. And here the great apostle Paul is talking to a young pastor, and even though there's a lot of duties, pastoral care duties that he would have, he's still encouraging him to do the work of an evangelist. Do the work of an evangelist, and people will follow you. People will follow you. A lot of times people will ask me, Pastor Art, I mean, really? Really? You can get Christians that want to go out on the street corner and preach the gospel? And they think that God's people, wow, they don't probably want to do that. You know, hey, aren't we going to turn some people off? And you know what? I found just the opposite to be true. I have found God's people love to do this. I believe there's a DNA in every Christian that's put there by the Holy Ghost that we need to share the gospel, and we desire souls to be saved. And if leadership, pastors and leaders in the church will lead the way, we will be amazed at how many Christians will follow and enter into that. And my heart as a pastor is I want to see God's people fully alive. I want to see them vibrant. I want to see them full of joy. It says in Corinthians that the kingdom of God's not eat and drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. I desire to see the people that I pastor to walk in that righteousness. We need a revival of righteousness again. We need to have a heart for desiring the things that God desires, for living right in the eyes of God. We need a revival of that. We need Christians again to have peace. We're living in a world. I'm here in the Hollywood area, and so many stars and famous people are still so empty. And how sad that we hear of even popular people that get so despaired, so much in despair and discouragement, they take their life. And peace, what an amazing, amazing thing that God is offering us, is we can have the peace of God rule in our heart and joy in the Holy Ghost. I desire to see Christians walking in that fully alive. And I have come to learn that one of the very best things you can do, pastors and leaders, is to position your people to taste the anointing of God. Oh, that is so good. That is so great. My children, have three wonderful children, and wow, I was able to raise them up in going to the streets and evangelizing, and a lot of people would say, wow, Art, I don't know if that's the way to raise your kids, doing that, but you know what? The opposite is true. They all love God. They share their faith in school and college and in elementary school. They're bold. They're bold for Jesus. And that wouldn't have happened unless they were positioned in a place where they need boldness. And we take teams all over the country. We're going to be here in Los Angeles March. If you're in the Los Angeles area, get a hold of me. We'd love to have you come and join up with us. And every member of evangelism, there's a place for everybody. There's a place for everybody in doing evangelism. We have an amazing team of worshipers that come out with us every week, and the anointing of God is what breaks the yoke of bondage. And as they worship, you can see their life being changed. You can see them going to a deeper place in God, because God has to live up to the challenge of the moment of using his people in a mighty way. So I encourage you, if you're a teacher, there's a place for you in evangelism. Wow, once we get out there, we have a cross that says Jesus died for you, live for him. We have signs. People will come over to us, and conversations will happen. A lot of times, lost people, be honest with you, lost people think about God a lot more than we think they do. And you being there, ready to talk to them, you get opportunities to answer some million-dollar questions that they might have. You become their teacher. You become their pastor. Right there on the street, you can give them a word of encouragement. You can speak the right thing at the right time, the right way to the right people. That's Holy Ghost utterance. And you can make a mighty difference no matter what your gift is. We have sweet ladies that come out on our team, and of all ages, even some that are senior saints, and sometimes they'll just give hugs. They'll give hugs to people, you know? It's all powerful because you're doing it under the anointing and under the great commission cause of Jesus Christ. So we would love to connect with you. I know there's people out there today that are watching this show. I know there's people out there that, as you hear me talk, something is stirring up in you. You were made to be a witness. You were made to have your life be amazingly meaningful. There's a purpose there. God's putting a passion in you that you want to make a difference in your generation. Boy, come join us. Come contact us. We'd love to visit with you and encourage you, help you, equip you. Go to the witnessdepot.org website. We have literature there that can equip you. I'm so excited because I believe we're just starting to see this movement. Talking about the beginning of another grassroots movement of God's people getting back on the mission field. And every person is either a missionary or they're still the mission field. And I encourage you to step into the calling that God has for you to be a missionary. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. The mandate of Jesus Christ, that is so powerful. If you study that out, Jesus is saying, go into your world and preach the gospel. Maybe you're a mechanic. Boy, God wants to work with you. Well, we can't do God's part. But you know what? He won't do our part. He's looking for a co-laborer. So go into the setting God has placed you. Maybe you're a teacher. Maybe you're a professional athlete. Maybe you're a housewife. But you know what? God has people, divine appointment people around you he's already placed. And how awesome is it to be used of God to make an eternal difference in somebody's life? My goodness, what a great way to live your Christian life. What a great adventure. Every day when I get up, I'm excited, and the first thought I have is, Lord, who do you have for me today? Who are you going to bring across my path today? We call it divine appointment. Who's going to be my divine appointment, Lord, that you're bringing to me? And I believe as we begin to do what they did in the book of Acts, we will begin to see what they saw. And I'm so excited. The last church, I believe, is going to be more glorious than the first church. Hallelujah. The first church was amazing. The first church, it says about Paul and his team, were turning the world right side up. Amen. And they were making a difference everywhere in the known world in just over 30 to 60 years. I believe that God is going to go out with a shout. I believe the last church is going to be greater than the first church. I believe that Jesus Christ is coming back for a pure and spotless bride. I believe Jesus is coming back for a church that's victorious and triumphant. I believe Jesus is coming back for a church that's not shrinking and hiding, but is going forward boldly in love and taking land for the kingdom of God. We're so excited. God has called us to go forth. Fear not. Fear not and go forth. The commandment of Jesus Christ. I believe that for the last days. We love you. I just pray for you. Lord, raise up your army. Raise up your remnant, Lord. Those that have a heart, deep in their heart, a calling there and a desire to make a difference in their world for you. I thank you so much. I just believe that, as John Wesley said, you want to draw a crowd, set yourself on fire, and people will come out to watch you burn. Watch you burn. Let's burn bright for Jesus, and we'll be amazed at how many people are drawn to that fire. And I don't know about you. I want my children and my grandchildren all to love Jesus. I want them to be victorious. I want them to be bold about their faith. I want them to have a heart of love and to be able to speak the truth and become a world changer. Will you join us? Will you join us? Will you join us in this cause? What a great cause. The cause of believing that we can change the world hand in hand with our Lord. And I want to see you if you're in the Los Angeles area. We have an outreach in Denver, June 16th through the 21st, Denver, Colorado. Come and enjoy the beautiful Rocky Mountain country with us for that week as we go and preach the gospel in the greater Denver area. Would love for you to be a part of anything we're doing because I believe it's going to help you go to a new level in your Christian life. We thank you. We love you. We're praying for you. Wow, the Bible says that the strong man's already been bound. Jesus has already put the devil to an open shame and triumphed over him in it. That's such good news. We have victory over the devil. We have victory over the world. We have victory over our sin. And now we can go forth and spoil the goods. Take the goods back that the enemy has robbed. We can take back what the devil's stolen and bring it back as a mighty harvest for our Lord. So, amen. We love you today. There's power in the blood of Jesus. We have victory today. Thanks be unto God that always causes us to triumph in Christ Jesus our Lord. So I want to encourage you today. You are special. God's made you for a time such as this. He's given you the DNA of himself. We have a divine nature. So we can be a partaker of godliness and have everything that we need in this present life, it says. We can be more than overcomer. God bless you.